Welcome to the UGC lecture series. This is the EPG Patashala lecture series on computer science, and we are talking about the paper data structures. This module and further modules, we will be discussing graphs in detail. This is the first module on graphs, and it gives an introduction to graphs. Now, this is the development team responsible for the creation of this module. Now, let us look at the learning objectives of this module. So, we are going to understand the components of graphs. We are going to describe the graph ADT and discuss the different representations of graphs, and then analyze the different representation of graphs. So, the keywords here are graphs, adjacency, undirected, direct and weighted type of graphs. So, we are going to look at all the three types of graphs. So, first let us look at what is a graph. It is a data structure that consists of a set of nodes, sometimes called vertices, both are used simultaneously, both are used synonymously, and a set of edges between the vertices. So, a set of edges describes some relationships between the vertices, okay, that is what they use the graph for. And graphs are similar to trees, except that they do not have as many restrictions as trees. We will come to what these restrictions mean later on. Now, graphs are also represent the relationship among the data items. So, a graph is generally represented as G is equal to V comma E, which consists of a set of vertices V and a set of edges E. And each edge is a pair V comma W, where V and W belong to the set of vertices. And a subgraph consists of a subset of the graph's vertices and a subset of its edges. So, a subgraph is will have a subset of V and a subset of E. Okay. So, this is an example of a graph, okay, where we have A, B, C, D, E, F. So, you have 6 vertices, that is a set. A, B, C, D, E, F is the set of vertices, and the edges are A, B, A, C, B, C, B, E, D, E and D, F. So, those are the edges, that is a set again, okay. So, this is the vertices are A, B, C, D, E, F, and the edges are A, B, A, C, A, D, B, C, B, E, D, E and D, F, as we already discussed. So, let us look at some terminology. There is a lot of terminology associated with graph sets. So, let us look at each of the terminologies. Once is you call a dense graph and a sparse graph. What is a dense graph? The number of edges will be more than the number of vertices. If it is actually, it will be double the number of, square the number of vertices. If it is approximately equal to the number of vertices, then you call it a sparse graph. Then you have undirected graph. The pair of vertices is unordered and the edge does not have a direction. So, the edge UV and the edge VU are same. You do not allow any self loops. Directed graph, edge UV goes from vertex U to vertex V and is notated as U going to V, and it is not the same as V going to U. Okay. So, each edge connects 2 vertices. One is in this particular directed graph situation, the terminology used is one of the vertices is called the source and the other is called the destination, and the edge normally connects the source to the destination. Here the order is significant. So, that is a directed graph. Then you have a weighted graph, where there are weights associated with the edges or the vertices, both can be both, normally edges. Now, some more terminology, a path. Now, what is a path? A path is a sequence of vertices that connect 2 nodes in a graph, sequence of edges that connect 2 nodes in a graph. The length of a path is the number of edges in it, okay. And path is simple if the vertices in sequence are distinct, that is, they do not connect among themselves again. Complete graph is a graph in which every vertex is directly connected to every other vertex, then you call it a complete graph. The number of edges in a complete directed graph with n vertices will be approximately of the order of n squared. So, this is a complete directed graph. So, you have if you have the number of edges in a complete directed with n vertices, here you have 4 vertices. So, here you will have 16 edges. And and some more again terminology, you have adjacent nodes. 2 nodes are adjacent if they are connected by an edge, then they are called adjacent nodes. If V0 and V1, there is an edge in an undirected graph, V0 and V1 are called adjacent. The edge V0, V1 is incident on the vertices V0 and V1. This is in an undirected graph. The same thing if it is a directed graph, V0, V1 is an edge in a directed graph, then V0 is adjacent to V1 and V1 is adjacent from V0, there is a difference. and the edge V0 V1 is incident on V0 and V1. A forest is an acyclic graph and a tree is a connected cyclic graph. So this is the difference between a graph is a generalized term where a forest is an acyclic graph, we will come to this in detail, and a tree is a connected cyclic graph. So a subgraph of a graph G is such that V of G dash is a subset of V of G and E of G dash is a subset of E of G, then G dash is called the subset of the graph G. So for examples of subgraph, let us take the graph G1, then the node 0 itself is a subgraph, 0, 1, 2 is a subgraph, 1, 2, 3 in this direction is also a subgraph. These are 4 subgraphs, there are many subgraphs possible, see that also. This is the 4 subgraphs of the graph G1. Now let us go to a terminology called connected component. A connected component of an undirected graph is a maximal connected subgraph. Okay. A directed graph is strongly, this is undirected. Now a directed graph is strongly connected if there is a directed path from Vi to Vj and also from Vj to Vi, then we call it strongly connected. Okay. A strongly connected component is a maximal subgraph that is strongly connected, subgraph, maximal subgraph. I will talk about what is that maximal subgraph, I have not discussed. So here we are talking about two things, connected component of an undirected graph and a connected strongly connected component of a directed graph which has to have a maximal subgraph. Now let us take an example of a connected component. This is not strongly connected. Strongly connected component maximal, because this is a directed graph, maximal, so 0 and 2 maximally connected subgraph. Okay. So let us now look at the terms degree. So degree of a vertex is the number of edges incident on that vertex. For a directed graph, the indegree, you have two terms. In an undirected graph, you have only degree. In a directed graph, you have in degree and out degree. In degree of a vertex V is the number of edges that has V as its head. An out degree of a vertex V is the number of edges that has V as its tail. Okay. So if Di is the degree of vertex I in a graph with n vertices and E the edges, the number of edges will be approximately E 0 to n minus 1 Di divided by 2. Now example of degree. So here you again have an undirected graph. So in this undirected graph, you have the degree written there. So 0 node and you have 1 having 3 edges, 2 having 3 edges, 0 having 3 edges and 3 having 3 edges. So that is the degree. Now if you take, that is in an undirected graph. Now if you take a directed graph, there you have 0 having 2, again undirected, 1 having 3, 2 having 3, 5 having 1, 6 having 1. You see that though it is a tree, the other direction is also considered. So this is considered as a graph. Okay. Now let us take the directed graph down G3. In that directed graph, for 0 you have in degree 1, out degree 1. For 1 you have in degree 1 and out degree 2. And for 2 you have in degree 1 and out degree 0. So this new term, this terms in degree and out degree are associated only with directed graph. Now let us look at trees as graphs. Every tree is a graph with some restrictions, as we already told you. Tree is directed, it is always from up to down. There are no cycles, so directed or undirected. There is a directed path from the root to every node. And so this is an example of a tree. So those red nodes are not allowed in a normal tree. So it is implicitly, in the previous case we saw something looking like a tree but it was considered as an undirected graph, but if you define it as a tree, it is implicit that there is a directed path from the root to every node. So the root is the starting point and you will have the direction like this. So in this is why you cannot have a disconnected component, you cannot have the red ones, you cannot have an 2 coming like that, D and E, they cannot be connected, and I and G cannot be connected. So this is trees as graph, those are the restrictions placed. Then you have directed acyclic graphs called as DAGs. So trees are graphs is the superset, in that you have directed acyclic graphs and under that you have trees. So DAGs are directed graphs with no cycles, that is the only condition. And so why use graphs? Graphs serve as models of a wide range of objects or entities. a roadmap, a map of airline routes, a layout of an adventure game world, a schematic of computers and connections that make up the internet, for example, the links between pages on the web, the relation between students and courses, the diagram of the flow capacities in a communication or transportation network. So you look at graphs and you can find that graph is a data structure that is widely, widely used in a large number of different types of applications. So roadmap in transportation, airline routes for ticketing or tour, route planning, layout in adventure game world, in tourism, in internet processing, web search, students and courses in a university, in a transportation or a communication network. So you, graphs are used in a large number of places. In fact, graphs is used as a model for a lot of applications. Let's see an application of an air flight system. So here you have, we have put it as an undirected graph. So Chennai, Hyderabad, Delhi, let's assume these are the air routes. Each vertex will represent a city. Now, when you're designing this, you have to decide what should be a vertex, what should be an edge, okay? So here each vertex represents a city. Each edge represents a direct flight between the two cities, and a query on direct flights can be asked. So a query on whether an edge exists will give you whether a direct flight is there. Query on how to get to a location, does a path exist from A to B? For example, from Delhi to Goa, if you want to go, you have to go from Delhi, Mumbai and then Goa. So that's a path. We can even associate cost to edges. So what is the cost of the air flight, weighted graphs, and then ask what is the cheapest path from A to B. So these are some of the questions that you can ask with this representation of an air flight system. We'll see another application of a wireless communication. You can represent it, this network by a weighted complete graph. Every two vertices are connected by an edge, and each edge represents the Euclidean distance Dij between the two stations. So each station uses certain power I to transmit messages. Given this power I, only a few nodes can be reached, okay, so the bold ones. So a station reachable by I then uses its own part to relay the message to other stations not reachable by I. A typical wireless communication problem. So how to broadcast between all stations so that they are all connected and the power consumption is minimized. This is a typical constraint satisfaction problem that you can solve with graphs. Now let's look at another important concept of graphs, that is the representation of graphs. So three popular computer representations of graph are available, though actually two major ones, and one is a subset of the, connected with the second one. So represents, we need to represent the vertex and the edge set, but in different ways. So one, you have the adjacency matrix, a very commonly used representation of a graph. Now here we are representing it, how it is actually represented in the memory is a different issue. Here we are talking about how it is represented. So use a 2D matrix to represent the graph, or you can have an adjacency list, use a 1D array of linked list. So that's a second one. The third one is an adjacency multi-list, and edge in an undirected graph is represented by two nodes in adjacency list representation. So this is a slightly modified version of adjacency list, but we are listing it here. We will discuss adjacency matrix and adjacency list in detail, okay. So let's look at adjacency matrix first. It is a square grid of Boolean values. A Boolean value just says whether there is an edge between the between a node, between two nodes. If the graph contains n vertices, the grid contains n rows and n columns, and for two vertices numbered 1 and j, the element at row I and column j is true if there is an edge from I to j, otherwise it is false. So the matrix is of size V to V, where V is the number of vertices. Each row column correspond to a distinct vertex j. If there is there exists an edge between ij, then there will be a cell there, otherwise it, 1 there, otherwise 0. In an undirected graph, 1 in ij means there is a 1 in ji also. 1 in jj means it is a self loop in the vertex. So these are the terminologies that we use. So let us look at an example, v into v, that is a number of nodes in which element ui is true only if and only if an edge exists between u and v. So space requirements for a graph with n nodes, you need adjacency matrix of the size 0 n square. So this is a small example, we will see a bigger example also. So you here you have Ram, Hari and Lakshmi, and you have Ram and Lakshmi connect, okay, we will see here. So this is the graph, Ram, Lakshmi and Hari, and you can see that it is a 3 nodes. So you have 3 into 3, 9, that is the size of the matrix, and the vertices are Ram, Lakshmi and Hari, and there is an edge between Hari and Lakshmi. So Hari and Lakshmi, there is a 1. Ram and Lakshmi, there is a 1. Lakshmi and Ram, this is a directed graph. Lakshmi and Ram, there is a 1. So this is the representation of the adjacency matrix. This is another representation of an here you have all the three are represented. If you see there, you have now if you look here, you can see one thing, you are not allowing self loops. So all the diagonal elements are 0, and it is a symmetric matrix because it is an undirected graph. Okay. The second one is a directed graph. So the again you are not allowing self loops. So all the diagonal elements are 0, but it is not symmetric because it is a directed graph. So this is the way that you represent. So we will go to an example of an undirected graph. If you look at this undirected graph, it is a graph with 9 nodes. So you have 9 into 9 matrix, and so if you take the first row is 1 and has that has 3 edges to 2, 6 and 9. So 2, 6 and 9 will have 1 there. Second one, now because it is undirected, it has 4 edges 1, 3, 6 and 7. So there will be a 1 in 1, 3, 6 and 7 and so on. So this is the adjacency matrix of an undirected graph. Now let us look at a weighted graph. The edges of a graph have weights assigned to them. These weights may represent the distance of one vertex from the other, the cost of going from one vertex to the other, and so many things. So this this edge weight gives a lot of flexibility to the graph, what we represent and how, what are the problems we can solve. So the adjacency matrix would keep the weights. So adjacency list has had a weight field to the node structure. So graph with weighted edges can also be called a network. So this is an adjacency matrix for a weighted graph. If you see here, the zeros correspond to 1 to 1, the all others are normally written as this with something, but the nodes, so for example 1 and 2, the 22 is the weight there. This is a directed graph also, okay. So we have not looked at graph, this is a weighted directed graph. And then we have the merits. So here we are using it to show weight as well as direction. So if you see here, between 1 and 2 you have 22, between 2 and 1 it is not connected because it is a directed graph. So this is the representation of a directed, weighted directed graph. Now let us look at some of the merits of adjacency matrix. For an undirected graph, the degree of any vertex is its row sum. So j is equal to thing will the adjacency of ij with j going to 1 to n 0 to n minus 1 will give you the degree. For a directed graph, the row sum is the out degree while the column sum is the in degree. So the row sum is given like this and the column sum will give you the out degree. So the complexity of checking edge number of or examining if g is correct. For g is undirected, it is order of n squared by 2, and for g is directed, it is of the order of n squared. Now let us look at the next representation, which is adjacency lists. So this is the second representation. We saw there were 3. The first one is adjacency matrix, the second is adjacency list. Adjacency matrix is a much more natural representation of the graph. Now let us look at this. There is one list for each vertex in G. So suppose you have V vertices, you will have V lists. The nodes in the list I represent the vertices that are adjacent from that vertice I. So for an undirected graph with n vertices and e edges, this representation requires n head nodes and 2e list nodes. Why 2e? Because both directions you have to represent, right? So every edge will have 2 entries. See declarations for adjacency list. So this is an adjacency representation of that graph that we saw. So V array list array in which each entry stores a linked list of all adjacent vertices. The adjacency list representation of a graph consists of an array of lists. Each array is the list of vertices adjacent to V. So space requirements is of the order of the number of edges. So this is an example of an adjacency list for an undirected graph. So if you take 1, 1 has undirected, so 2 and 6, 2 has 4, 1, 3, 6 and 7, 3 has 2, 4, 6 and 8, 4 has 3 and 5, 5 has 4, 6 and 8, 6 has 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 7, 8. Normally you try to put it in the order. 7 has 2, 6, and 8, and 9 and 8 has 3, 6, 3, 5, 6, and 7. So that's the adjacency list for an undirected graph. The number of head nodes is the number of vertices, and the number of nodes that you have is equal to the number of edges. Okay, so that's why the space is reduced. So the number of edges will tell you how many nodes you have in the linked list. So this is adjacency list for a directed graph. So directed graph, it is even more. So here is an example of that. So for 1 is connected to 2 and 6, 2 is connected to only 3, 3 is connected to 4 and 6, 4 is connected to 5, 5 is connected to 8, 6 is connected to 4, 5 and 8, 7 is connected to 6 and 8, and 8 is connected to 1. So this is the adjacency list for a directed graph. So degree of a vertex in an undirected graph is the number of nodes that is there in each adjacency list. The number of edges in a graph is determined as order of n plus e. An out degree of a vertex in a directed graph is the number of nodes in the adjacency list. In degree of a vertex in directed graph, you cannot find out easily because you have to traverse the whole data structures. So that is for the directed graph. Out degree and degree of a vertex of a directed undirected graph and in the out degree of a directed graph are calculated the same way, but in degree it is difficult to find using adjacency list. So you can have a sequential representation of adjacency list also, sequentially pack the nodes on the adjacency list. So this is one way in which it is packed, and node 1 and node n plus 2e plus 1 may be used. So node 1 to node n minus 1 gives the starting point of for vertices. Node n is equal to n plus 2e plus 1, and node n plus 1 to node n plus 2e is the head node of each edge. Vertices adjacent from vertex I are stored from ni to ni plus 1 minus 1 depending on the degree. Number of edges in G may be determined also easily. So that is a sequential representation. Normally adjacency lists come with linked list representation. Next you have adjacency multilist. Now here an edge in an undirected graph is represented by 2 nodes in the adjacency list representation. In adjacency multilist, the list in which nodes may be shared among several lists, an edge is shared by 2 different parts. There is exactly 1 node for each edge. This node is on the adjacency list of each of the 2 vertices in which it partakes incident to. So for example, marked vertex 1, vertex 2, path 1, path 2. So example, so here you have an example, you have 4 nodes 0, 1, 2, 3, and each is represented like this 0, 1, N2, N4, okay. So it comes, it is connected to N2, N4, and 1, 0 is a path that exists, 1, 0, and the edge is 0, 1, so edge 0, 1 comes in a path from 0 and 1. So this way it is represented. All the edges are represented as 0, 1, 0, 2, then 0, 3, then that is all. Then 1, 2, 1, 3, and then 2, 3. So it is not represented more number of times, it is just represented, and edge 2, 3 connects 2 and 3, 1, 3 connects nodes 1 and 2 and so on. So this is a representation of how adjacency list, multilist. So now we will so adjacency multilist is a variation of adjacency list. So we will basically compare when we analyzing, we will analyze only adjacency matrix and adjacency list. So when you take adjacency matrix and then when you take adding or removing edges, the adjacency matrix is only a small constant, but in adjacency list it is of the order of n, where the number of vertices, n is the number of vertices. Checking if edge is present or not, adjacency matrix again a small constant supports the first operation almost in constant time. Adjacency list again of the order of n, linked adjacency has linear running time with the length of the list on an average. So it is an average method. Iterating through the vertices edges, this for an adjacency matrix of the order of n, but in an adjacency list, because you are storing only the edges, there if there are e edges, it is of the order of e, which is will be less than the number of vertices assuming. So this is the analysis of adjacency matrix versus adjacency list. So continuing that, if you want to find all the vertices adjacent to a given vertex, adjacency list tends to support this operation more efficiently than the adjacency matrix. So this is, if you want, so remember when we started off with abstract data types or ADT, we said that we have to design each ADT and its implementation depending upon whether we want, what are the operations we want for a particular application. So depending on the application, if you want, this is one of the important operations that you constantly do for that application, find all vertices adjacent to a given vertex, then it is better to choose adjacency list. But if you are going to have some other operations like we saw in the previous slide, then it is better to choose adjacency matrix. So that is very important, the choosing what operations you want for the ADT. So graph ADT, what are the operations you want, what is the implementation you want. So adjacency list tends to support this operation specifically, and both are off the order of n in the worst case. That is, worst case means when it is a complete graph. Now let us look at memory usage. Adjacency matrix obviously uses more memory, requires n squared cells. So if you have 100 squared, adjacency list on the other hand requires an array of n pointers and number of nodes equal to twice the number of edges in the case of an underrated graph. So if you have n nodes and you have say some x edges, then you have n to represent the head nodes and x into 2 if you want to represent, if it is an undirected graph. If it is a directed graph, it will have n edges only, okay. So the choice of the implementation is based on which operations are more frequent, which already told, whether a good set ADT is available, and the average number of edges per vertex. This is also very important when you choose what is the implementation. A matrix is wasteful for sparse graphs because you are actually allocating n into n, and if it is very sparse, there will be more zeros than ones, and it takes approximately of the order of n squared space. So with this we complete the introduction to graphs. So we have explained the components of graphs, we have described the graph ADT, and then we discussed the different representations of graphs, where we looked at adjacency matrix, adjacency list basically based on head nodes represented using an array with linked list pointing to all the nodes corresponding to each, I mean all the edges corresponding to each node. And we analyzed the different representation of graphs for different operations that you can do, and as we already discussed, each application decides that what are the operations you do quite frequently. So with this we have completed the introduction to graphs, and graph, we have just looked at what is a graph ADT. Now we will go and look at different operations that we do with graphs as we go along in future modules. Thank you.